We have a real treat this morning. It's my pleasure to introduce Ambassador Robert Gallucci. And I can't do justice to your introduction, but I'll try as you work your way up here. As most of you know, Bob is now the president of the MacArthur Foundation as of July, this past July. But before that, he served as dean of the Edmund Walsh School of Foreign Service at Georgetown University for 13 years. And before that, Bob worked for over 20 years in the U.S. government, mainly at the State Department, where he used his excellent diplomatic skills everywhere from the Sinai Peninsula to Pyongyang, from peacekeeping to nonproliferation. I've known him for over 10 years now, I know, and he's been a real mentor to me and a driving force behind what I do, and I always offering me a gentle ear and listening to my problems and my indecisions, and it's just been a real pleasure to know Bob for that long and to just have him pushing me and inspiring me to follow in his distinguished footsteps. So with that, just introduce Ambassador Bob Gallucci. Thank you.
Thanks, Alex. Good morning, everyone. We all are grateful to you, Alex, and to Ken, to the Fissile Materials Working Group, to the Stanley Foundation, especially for organizing this event. And while it's required for me to say it, I really do mean it. I'm very happy to be with you here today and have this opportunity to discuss this topic. But let me digress for a moment. I was looking over the list of attendees, and I've been talking to people since Alex got me here at 6 this morning. I had an opportunity to do that, to meet people. And something is very, very clear to me, and that is that this audience really doesn't need a speech from me on this issue. You're going to get one, but you don't need one. And I want you to know I understand that, and I, like you, I'm sure will be looking forward to a discussion period, which we will get to, I think, before too long. Since just after our founding in 1980, the MacArthur Foundation has supported non-governmental experts and institutions around the world working to reduce the risk from nuclear weapons. Among other achievements, these grantees helped advance U.S.-Soviet arms control talks, launched the Cooperative Threat Reduction Initiative in the early 1990s, and generated plans you will be discussing here today to secure and eliminate fissile materials worldwide. Their independent work has informed successive U.S. administrations, as well as policymakers and the public worldwide. I'm glad to see many of our grantees here today and want to assure you that we consider you and your work a very, very good investment. But we are here today because, despite our grantees' best efforts, the global risks from nuclear weapons and nuclear terrorism in particular continue to loom large. The first question to ask, and it's a good one, is whether nuclear terrorism is just a fantasy, the stuff of novels and sensationalistic, if sometimes fun, television shows like the American series 24. For me, that's really a key question, and I have been involved in debates on nuclear terrorism. You might wonder what that debate sounds like. I mean, who's in favor on the other side? But it really is over whether this is a real threat or not. So let's discuss how likely it is that a nuclear explosive device may be detonated in a major city by a non-nuclear actor such as a terrorist group. And here, for a little precision, by nuclear explosive device I do mean an improvised or fabricated weapon driven by a nuclear explosion and not a radiation dispersal device, an RDD, driven by a conventional explosion. Classical strategists define threats as the product of an event's magnitude and its probability. Now, not much need be said about magnitude when it comes to nuclear weapons, but maybe just a little. A Hiroshima-like device, and that's the one we tend to look at as a model, using highly enriched uranium in a gun-type design, would produce about 12 kilotons of explosion yield. If it were detonated in a major city at ground level, and this is all speculative, but deaths would likely total somewhere between 80,000 and 200,000, depending on the precise yield, location, time of day, winds, and so on. Casualties would include prompt deaths from burns and blast, overpressure and wind, radiation, and additional deaths over 4 to 6 weeks from radiation effects. These numbers do not include anticipated deaths from increased rates of various types of cancer over many years, hundreds of thousands of dead people. Clearly, such a device would have a horrific effect on human beings. It would also inflict substantial economic damage, which could result in long-lasting psychological trauma to people and to a nation. The magnitude of the threat, then, is considerable. What is the probability of it happening? I'm about to go on to probability, but I will note that in everything I'm saying, I'm talking about one device going off. But it's occurred to me and other people that it could as easily be two devices or three devices, particularly with an enemy that likes to do things in twos and threes. And the magnitude would obviously be much greater. What's interesting is I don't think the probability would be much less. Is you can imagine a couple of baseballs disappearing or softballs of material, you can imagine a few more without too much difficulty. And then the catastrophe multiplies. Again, classical strategists would divide probability into two factors, the intent and then the capability of the adversary. Again, not much need be said about intent, just a little. Al-Qaeda is the most likely non-national perpetrator, I think most people agree. There is ample evidence of Al-Qaeda's intent to acquire nuclear weapons, weapons of mass destruction. Al-Qaeda has demonstrated a particular interest in nuclear explosive capability. So far, there is no evidence I know of that they have succeeded. Thank you. I did not put mine on stun either, but it would be a good idea. Well, we don't know that there's evidence that they succeeded. It's important to recognize when one thinks about what an intelligence community knows, anybody's intelligence community, to ask a question, this is a safety tip for those still in government, with what confidence does the intelligence community address that question? With what confidence would an intelligence community, the American or any other, say that Al-Qaeda does not now have the material? I mean, I think we know that we do not have high confidence, a good grip on fissile material, down to the level of a few tens of kilograms. So we really don't know very much with confidence. On the question of capability, we must do some intelligence speculation on the basis of available evidence. Logically, it seems to me there are two possible routes to acquiring nuclear weapons for Al-Qaeda. First, they could buy or steal a weapon or convince some country to provide one to them. Second, they could buy, steal, or convince some country to give them the necessary fissile material, highly enriched uranium or plutonium, and then build their own improvised nuclear device. The question, again, though, is, are either of these scenarios possible, plausible, or even probable? I'm certain both are possible and plausible, but I think the chances of Al-Qaeda acquiring fissile material and making its own improvised nuclear device are greater than the chances it will get an already fabricated weapon and detonate that. Nuclear weapons are far better secured and accounted for than is nuclear material in all states that have them. That in turn leads to two more questions. First, where would the fissile material come from? And second, could Al-Qaeda actually make an improvised nuclear device if it acquired the necessary highly enriched uranium or plutonium? It is possible that fissile material could leak from Russia or elsewhere in the former Soviet Union, or from Pakistan, or indeed any number of other countries that possess it. These include the United Kingdom, France, Germany, India, South Africa, Japan, the United States, and many more. But fissile material is most likely to leak, I'd argue, from a state that has a lot of it, some of which may not be adequately secured, or from a state that may have somewhat less, but must cope with internal threats from extremists and general instability. Some fissile material has already gone missing. We're here today because we know that more could go missing in the future. But could a nuclear weapon be made by Al-Qaeda? Men and women of goodwill have become convinced can disagree on this point. The challenge, everybody seems to agree, is not in the design, which is, well, relatively easily obtained, but in the demands of precision manufacture. I think it's fair to say that's not easy. But a relatively simple gun-type device, like the bomb that was dropped over Hiroshima in 1945, could plausibly be constructed by a well-funded terrorist group if it had the necessary highly enriched uranium. I would even argue, somewhat uphill, that given sufficient time and purchased expertise and equipment, such a group might even be capable of building a far more challenging implosion design using plutonium. We can talk about that. To summarize, I am persuaded that it is possible, plausible, and over time, probable that a determined and well-financed terrorist group with the necessary fissile material could manufacture and detonate a nuclear weapon devastating the population of a city. So, then, who is at risk? There may be a perception that only the United States or maybe Western European nations are likely targets. I think this would be a mistake. The detonation of a nuclear explosive device would be a major terrorist achievement and a terrible, terrible blow to the fabric of any society. It would certainly undermine faith in governments and their capacity to protect their own population. I would say that any country that has suffered significant terrorist attacks, foreign or domestic, needs to take this threat seriously. So what can we do in response to a threat of this magnitude and of this likelihood? Historically, we have responded to the threat of nuclear attack by relying on deterrence. In other words, we promise an enemy that should he attack, we will respond with devastating force. That sounds good, but an even better approach would be to deny an enemy access to one's territory so as to prevent the attack in the first place. But in an age of intercontinental ballistic missiles, the so-called defense by denial is not so easily done. Not in 1950 and not in 2010. So when dealing with other nation states, we rely on deterrence because defense by denial is someplace between hard and impossible, and because we assume that no nation is prepared to be annihilated. But how does one deter an enemy who values your death more than his life? Deterrence provides little security against the suicide bomber, but that does not mean that it is of no use at all. We may, I underline may, we may be able to deter states from transferring a nuclear weapon or fissile material to terrorists, and perhaps, and I underline perhaps, compel states to secure fissile material more effectively by threatening consequences for negligence, particularly if their material is used in an improvised nuclear device. We should talk more about that. Of course, this raises the question of whether we will know whether a nuclear weapon or the fissile material in an improvised nuclear device, where it came from. Can we reliably determine the true source to deliver the threatened consequences? The state of the science of nuclear forensics, I can only say that some attribution is possible now, and more may be in the future. But relying on the credibility of our ability for accurate attribution, the linchpin of an effective deterrent strategy, would not seem to be prudent. Not at this time, and maybe not ever. So if we cannot deter with confidence effectively, we should try to deny a nuclear armed adversary access to our territory. But this approach is hardly foolproof either. We should do what we can to secure our borders against the clandestine introduction of nuclear material. But we should not rely on detecting and capturing a bomb as it enters our territories. We should instead look upstream and deny terrorists access to the fissile material they need to make a bomb. Hence, the nuclear summit and our conference here today. As we think about how to do this, we should remind ourselves just how large a task this is. I'm told that good numbers these days are something like 1,600 metric tons of highly enriched uranium, 500 metric tons of plutonium. More or less, that's a lot of stuff. Logically, the first thing to do when you're in a hole, as they say, is to stop digging. So it seems to me the first step to denying access to fissile material is to stop producing any more highly enriched uranium or separating any more plutonium. The second step would be to truly secure existing fissile materials, securing them truly to what Graham Allison once called the gold standard. For many governments, I understand that this second step will have to come first, but we should talk more about that too. And third would be to eliminate the fissile material that exists by blending down the highly enriched uranium and disposing of the plutonium. Irretrievably, or if absolutely necessary, retrievably in a way that makes it extremely difficult to access. Some other observations follow from this prescription. First, we should not limit our concern about the nuclear programs in Iran and North Korea to their acquisition of nuclear weapons, and that is the popular way of proceeding. At least as great a concern is that either government might transfer fissile material to a terrorist group, not expecting that we would, in fact, be capable of tracing the origin of the material back to them if it were used in an improvised nuclear device. Now, for those of you who think this is fanciful, please recall that North Korea secretly built a plutonium production reactor in Syria and suffered no negative consequences that I know of as a result. So why would they not sell a few baseballs of plutonium or softballs of highly enriched uranium to Al-Qaeda? Second, those nations looking to nuclear power as an essential part of their energy strategy, particularly in this day with great concern about climate change and carbon fuels, these nations should make sure that plutonium recycling in any form is not part of their plans. Clearly, we should talk about that. Simply spiking the plutonium, for instance, something I keep hearing about over and over again, will not do. It is too easily reversible. I know all this is controversial, but I worry greatly about plutonium in motion in a civilian nuclear fuel cycle. Third, in the real world, credible information that illuminates a threat makes a big difference. More than any other threat we face, the threat of nuclear terrorism demands the sharing of operational intelligence between governments. I will say no more about that. Finally, I think more people and governments would be inclined to act and cooperate with others to act to counter nuclear terrorism if they were persuaded that the threat was real. This morning, I have been trying to make it real for you. The detonation of a nuclear explosive device would be the quintessential act of terrorism in the 21st century. It really does pose a real and present danger to the security of nations around the world. We should not allow our response to fall short of the dimensions of such a threat. Ladies and gentlemen, have a nice day. Alex tells me that we have time for questions. I hope I said a few things that might prompt a few, and I ask Alex to please manage.
I'll go ahead and moderate the questions. If you could just raise your hand, state your name and organization, and people with mics will come to you. Yes, sir. I'm sorry, can I just, while you're making your way through the crowd, we are at capacity, actually over capacity, so for those in the back, there are seats here up front, so if you want to just take a moment to just sit, it's going to be a long day. In a good way.
I was about to say, Alex, that was on the verge of being rude, but it's okay.
I'm Edmund Reynolds, Executive Director of Citizens to Stop Nuclear Terrorism. The thought about the North Koreans supplying material for a bomb or an actual bomb seems to me, in a way, the biggest threat if they are as wanton as you described. I was wondering if you could just elaborate on that a little bit, just to put your realistic sense of the possibility of that happening. Yes.
Edward, thank you. I must say that, to the best of my knowledge, the United States government was, surprised. To learn that the North Koreans were building a plutonium production reactor in Syria. And that sentence just is stunning to me. So that goes back to what I said before about what we should expect anybody's intelligence community to know about transfers with confidence. I mean, yes, they might find out about something being transferred, but that's not really the question. The question is what you could expect them to know. And if this could happen, because it takes a bit to build a plutonium production reactor. If this could happen without us discovering it, and this is North Korea, a country that we put a fair amount of focus on, and this is Syria, which is located in a fairly important region where we have a fair amount of focus, and we not see it. That tells me that if we are looking for relatively small amounts of material moving, we should not expect to catch that movement. Moreover, I was surprised, again to the best of my knowledge, I think, to find that sort of nothing happened afterwards to North Korea. I mean, now you may ask, well, what did you want us to do? Well, I don't know. We could talk about that. But something, that was rude. I mean, this transfer, that was quite extraordinary. And if one wants a regime of deterrence here, because defense is so bloody hard, then that kind of thing cannot go without response. Now, yes, there was a response for the Syrians from the Israelis, but there was not one for North Korea from the United States. So I worry about that, and I worry about that as a precedent. It is useful to point to this when others will say there's nothing real about this threat. Who would transfer? I mean, I'm listed Iran. When I think about the Iranian case, and I worry about the Iranian case, yes, I worry about an Iranian nuclear weapons program that turns out to produce a domino effect in the Middle East, and other countries respond, Arab countries to a Persian threat. Yes, I worry about all that. But before all that, if there's evidence of the production of highly enriched uranium, eventually there'll be sufficient highly enriched uranium that some could be shared. Is this a plausible thing for Iran to do? Shall we have an argument about the national interests of Iran? No, not now. But I would be looking ahead and saying this is not a good situation. Iran does, I think, it's fair to say, transfer conventional weapons to groups which at least the United States regards as terrorist groups. So this does not seem like overreaching to be worried about transfers from such states. And this is different from the other model, because I used the word leakage when I was talking about the United States and France and Russia and Pakistan, because we don't think of those countries as having governments that would authorize a transfer. In the case of Iran and North Korea, we don't think about the material leaving without an authorized transfer. So it's a different situation, a different model for deterrence. There, and I told you everything I know, and some stuff I don't know.
Kenneth.
Annette Benedict, with Bulletin of the Atomic Sciences. Could you say some words about the civilian nuclear power ambitions, I guess? You've talked about governments, and we're certainly aware of the way in which governments could transfer materials. Is there a need to worry about plutonium in civilian plants, and what is the role and responsibility, would you say, of the nuclear industry as a whole?
Okay, Kenneth, you put your finger on, I think, one of the nasty little elements of this problem of the securing fissile material. Let me just pull out a couple of these strings, and maybe others will want to follow on. First, for technical reasons, because of the design of weapons and problem of pre-ignition with using plutonium in a gun-type device, we all have come to know that highly enriched uranium is particularly appealing for a terrorist using the simplest of devices. Okay. That's good that we all know that now. And it should mean, it should have some implications for getting rid of highly enriched uranium, getting it out of civil use entirely for research reactors or for, I'll call them more exotic reactor designs. We should stay away from that and limit enrichment to what's necessary, apparently, for naval reactors, but not more than that. The plutonium problem, though, I think is a serious one, a critical one. It is the other material that can be used to make a nuclear weapon. Certainly, a state can use it to make a nuclear weapon, but you get into very technical and nasty discussions about whether and under what circumstances, what kind of terrorists could, over what period of time, make some kind of device with a true nuclear yield from plutonium. I'd rather not have that resolved by a terrorist group myself. When I think about fuel cycles, this is, to me, the technology that will not die. And it is the idea of either a robust thermal recycle for our generation reactors or reprocessing for the purpose of some version of a fast reactor which will produce more plutonium. I know there are technologies that, reprocessing technologies that are said to be more proliferation resistant, and I think they all deserve to be looked at. But the state of affairs, such as I am aware of them, and I recognize I'm not technically competent to speak to what may be at the cutting edge, but I think the burden is on those who would argue that we have safe reprocessing, a phrase which I would not now leap to use. So I understand that states are reprocessing. I understand that states plan to reprocess. I think that the jury remains out on the economic wisdom of this over time and for what size or economy of reactors it makes sense. And one wants to say, recognizing that it sounds paternalistic, that only for the largest economies might there be an economy of scale. But I'm not even sure that makes sense. So what I'm getting to here is, at the moment, it seems to me that we ought, those of us who are concerned about this issue of terrorism, and the nuclear issue, and securing fissile material, ought to stand against reprocessing and the use of plutonium for nuclear energy. This is not an attack on nuclear energy. I really think the argument is very convincing that for a robust energy mix aimed at reducing carbon fuels, there is a place for nuclear energy. And what I would be looking for, therefore, to the extent we're talking about the current generation of thermal reactors, is what we used to call a once-through fuel cell.
Great. Thanks for the question, Kenneth. Also, we're having a panel later after lunch on the rationale and challenges of eliminating civil HEU. That was one of the recommendations that the Fissile Materials Working Group made to President Obama. I saw a hand in the middle there, sir. Just wait for Mike.
I'm Ambassador Keller, Mexico Ambassador to the United Nations and chairing Committee 1540 Security Council. So my question is on the role of international organizations. How do you see in the future the role of international organizations? Do we need new arrangements? Do we need a new regime going from the 1540s to some kind of more intrusive mechanism, sanctions to countries that would be transferring the illicit materials? How do you see the international part? Thank you.
Thank you. There will be a panel on multilateral approaches to this problem. And I'm prepared to believe that some de jure mechanisms, multilateral mechanisms, will be required ultimately to create a regime which has a durable substance to it. I am sympathetic to those who don't want to try to leap to that and would prefer to keep the consensus together around unilateral commitments by states to adopt rigorous measures of control. We're not there yet, much less multilateral. So I would say hold that thought. From my perspective, I would say hold that thought. I'd be looking for states to make binding commitments themselves to standards of control of fissile material, and then moving eventually, as appropriate, to a multilateral arrangement to bind states together. But I think I see in the planning of the White House, in coordination with other countries, a step-by-step approach with having a very high value placed upon keeping a consensus of governments together against nuclear terrorism and for securing fissile material. Whatever you may think about plutonium recycle or anything else, it's very hard to come out against securing the fissile material you have. So starting there seems like a prudent thing to do, and I have no problem with that.
Great. Someone up here in the front.
Thank you. Mark Fitzpatrick from the International Institute for Strategic Studies, and Ambassador Blue. Thank you very much. You said, if I wrote it down right, that it's possible, plausible, and over time probable. That kind of covers all the bases of probability.
That's fine.
That a well-funded terrorist group could build and detonate a nuclear explosive device. And it's that over time probable that I want to ask about. That suggests that the trend is in the wrong direction. Is that because terrorist groups are more interested now than they did, or are there more possibilities for them despite all of the interest and efforts of international governments to address the problem? Are we moving in the wrong direction?
You know, Mark, I don't know actually the answer to that question. I know what I intended, which was not to have you ask that question. What I intended was to say that time is a very important factor here. That whatever you all may think is the probability that there'll be a detonation of a nuclear device by a terrorist group in a city this year. I hope most of you think there's only a very small chance of that. There's some chance of that, but very small. And if you ask, well, what about over the next 5 years, over the next 10 years, over the next 20 years? This problem, I do not believe, as effective as the day's events, today's and tomorrow's, may be, and I hope they're very effective, are not going to eliminate this threat. And I am struck by the fact that we all are going to have to live with this for a long time. This material is going to be around for a long time. My logical steps, you know, stop producing more, secure what you've got, then get rid of what you've got. Even if that was accepted, and it won't be, I would predict that quite that way, it's going to take a long time. 4 years, we've heard, to secure all the fissile material. That's good. But it'll be secure and it will be there. So what I wanted to say by putting it that way is that what we have to think about is that we have to live with this problem over a long period of time, and that we have to get to a point at which the probability changes in any particular year and becomes less. That's what I was trying to convey. Failing action on our part, this probability, this problem, does not improve with age.
Reggie. This is Rajiv, the Economist for Defense Strategy Analysis, India. I share, I think, the global concern that we have to take care of nuclear terrorism. The only problem is how to approach this. There are diverse approaches. And we have come together here to have a consensus, a common viewpoint. With this spirit, I would like to comment on your proposition or assertion about safe reprocessing problem. I remember on December 3rd, I talked about closed nuclear fuel cycle. This is considered a safe option in India. There was a probe. I went back and talked to my own scientists, the Indian scientific nuclear scientist community, and they were then convinced about the safety of reprocessing and closed nuclear fuel cycle. The shape that by reprocessing, you minimize the danger of spent fuel. You have something under control. And you also minimize the danger of nuclear waste. So they were well convinced that they can manage it. And as we are discussing, that is a national control. So I think we should give autonomy or give independence to the national governments, how they manage it. We should not have any preconceived notion that that will be very dangerous. They are managing it, and I'm sure they will manage it.
Thank you. May I comment on that? I think it is obvious that sovereign nations will take advantage of their sovereignty and make decisions about nuclear energy that they think is in their country's best interest. And I think India has done that, and I am not surprised or expect that. It is also appropriate, I think, for another country, citizens of another country, to say, when we look at the risks associated with the choices made by India, Japan, France, or whomever, we are concerned about those choices. We recognize there's a risk from poorly managed radioactive waste. We recognize there's a risk to accumulations of spent fuel with no apparent plan for ultimate disposal, and then we recognize a risk from the separated plutonium that will have to be handled and managed in a fuel cycle, closed though it may be. And it is reasonable for us to say we find these risks greater than those risks. And we would prefer, in the interests of humanity, that the decision not be made to do this by another sovereign state. And that's all I'm doing. Thank you.
I gotcha. Right here, waving your hand. Go ahead.
Thank you. My name is Mustafa Kibarol. I'm coming from Turkey. I'm teaching course in arms control disarmament at Bilkent University in Ankara. I was formerly with Bell for Center, working with Jean Walsh, Matt Baum here, and also previously at the Center for Non-Proliferation Studies. Well, I thank you for organizing this meeting and also inviting me, but I should thank you even more for writing that letter on September 30th, which is my birthday, by the way, to President Obama, which I believe was sort of the reason for this summit today here. Because we have to be on the same page with all the governments in the world who have this material in order to convince them that there's this threat which is real. Because I want to give you a perspective from Turkey. I'm the academic advisor of the Turkish General Staff, which put together a symposium just a month ago in Ankara, International Global Terrorism International Cooperation. And I invited Professor Graham Allison to deliver the opening keynote address where he talked about all this nuclear terrorism. And after that, his presentation, which was excellent as always, many people came to me and said, Mustafa, should we really worry about this? Is it real? I said, you should worry even more. Because, I mean, I 100% agree with what you said. But unless all these governments out there who are meeting today agree with us, no matter what we discuss here, may not have that much impact on, you know, implementing things on the ground. So therefore, this meeting, as well as this summit, thank you very much for all this. Just wanted to say this. Thank you.
Thank you.
Great. We can go to Sharon and then to Ayman. Just mixing it up a little bit from both sides of the room.
Thanks, Bob, for opening up this conference for us. I was heartened by, Sharon Swissoni from the Center for Strategic and International Studies. I was heartened by your call for stopping the production of HEU and plutonium recycling. It seemed to me, though, that you made an exception for either the use of HEU in naval reactors or the production of HEU in naval reactors. One or the other. I don't know if you're thinking that we should continue to produce it or just use our stockpiles. But in any event, I think this points to a fundamental problem that we have in the nuclear world. And it's not just in the, you know, for nuclear weapon states and have-nots, but it's the advanced nuclear states and the others. One of the virtues of this nuclear security summit is that it kind of levels the playing field. It's something that we're all supposed to be doing together, everybody's responsibility. So would you like to revise your exception for HEU or naval reactors?
Here's the problem I have with the HEU for naval reactors. I actually don't know what the requirements are for the United States' submarine force, aircraft carriers, etc., for HEU, and I don't know the requirement for other countries. So I am unwilling to put that need in the same box as HEU for research reactors or for more advanced reactors that may require highly enriched uranium, at least initially. For the second, for research reactors, et cetera, for all other civil uses, and that's, I guess, the military, that's naval uses, not civil use, but for all civil use, I'd be prepared to say that I do not understand a need for highly enriched uranium that cannot be met by other means. And that ought to be an objective. We ought to be working towards the end of the production of highly enriched uranium and then blending down all excess stocks of highly enriched uranium. But it is unreasonable to say that without saying, oh, and by the way, I understand highly enriched uranium has been used and is essential to naval reactors. I don't know what to do with that, except is it possible to meet that need without further enrichment to high levels? Plausibly. But I just don't have the data, so I can't really speak to that. But I think more generally, the proposition, I think, for this group, for the international community, would be to say we don't need to enrich uranium to high levels for civil purposes anymore. And stop there.
Ayman? And then we have maybe time for one or two more questions. Sorry, I know there are a lot of questions. I'm trying to get them on.
Thank you, Ambassador. My name is Ayman Khalid. I'm from the Arab Institute for Security Studies. I thank you for your presentation this morning. No doubt that focusing on nuclear security measures is a noble effort, is an important effort. However, the total emphasis on nuclear security measures, which is a symptom or a manifestation of a symptom, while totally ignoring, totally neglecting the threat, the problem of a growing proliferation of nuclear weapons, is somewhat problematic. I hope you agree with me.
Of course I agree. I agree with you that if the international community or the people who are here were ignoring nuclear proliferation, or indeed arms control more broadly, that would be a huge mistake. I don't see that. What I see the governments doing that have come here to Washington and the people in this room doing is focusing on one part of the nuclear security problem, and that's securing fissile material against a particular threat, and that's terrorism, non-national actors. This focus doesn't mean that we are unconcerned about the spread of nuclear weapons to additional states, or that we're unconcerned about Article 6 obligations of the nuclear weapon states to reduce and ultimately eliminate their nuclear weapon stockpiles. That's all there too. So please engage in, with your colleagues in the discussion today here about how to secure this material without assuming that if you do that, you're participating in the legitimization of the spread of nuclear weapons. You're not. That's another concern. It's just not the concern today. Thank you.
Sure. Okay, great. I saw a hand back there.
Mm-hmm.
The lady who I don't know.
Hello, I'm Caroline Durand from France and coming from Arriba. So it will not be a surprise for you that I would oppose your position on non-proliferation and recycling. I think that on the contrary, recycling in a proper manner, in good conditions, can be a support to non-proliferation efforts. I will intervene later in this debate and I will make some proposal on that point. I think that, as you recalled, this meeting is about security, and I think we should focus on the security of fissile material, be it plutonium, separated plutonium, MOX fuels, or others. I think this is really the point, and we have to prioritize, I think, the dangers, threats, and I think that recycling industry may be also a solution. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, I did. As soon as you said you were from Arriba, I did anticipate that that would be your question. Let me say this about that, as they say. I think it is entirely appropriate that you do focus upon securing material, and that's what we're doing here today. And we don't need to settle the issue of plutonium recycle in thermal reactors or the desirability of pursuing fast reactor designs. We don't have to settle that today. We can focus on this. I agree entirely. That said, since Alex and Ken had a bad judgment to invite me to speak this morning, I could not pass up the opportunity of offering what I thought was an essential logic to not producing any more of this material, and of still coming to a conclusion myself that in this balance, that I still come out thinking that the benefits of extracting fuel value from plutonium by recycle or of another design of reactor, a fast reactor, the virtues there are outweighed by the risks. And that I was sharing with you because I had the opportunity to do so.
And the last question, I have Doug Shaw in the back.
Thanks. Doug Shaw from the George Washington University's Elliott School of International Affairs. Thinking about the technology that won't die and how we've been debating that for a number of decades, and it's obvious that the challenges we're wrestling with today will be with us for decades to come, and that they're increasingly technical in nature, and the traditional frame of a political science basis for understanding nuclear security is decreasingly adequate to these challenges. How should higher education be organizing itself to educate the next generation of nuclear security specialists? Thank you.
Thanks, Doug. I have to tell you that in the midst of that, when you said the words political science, I had to stop a twitch coming into my shoulder here. The answer that I would have, even if I wasn't at the MacArthur Foundation, but particularly because I'm at the MacArthur Foundation, is that we ought to be educating our students, and this is the grand thing, we all ought to in countries around the world, so that our students are generally technically aware, so they're able to deal with public policy issues that are of vital importance to their own countries and to the world. So that's as a general matter of education, that's an obligation to have a certain level of scientific and technical awareness so that the population can participate in this discussion. Secondly, of course, as you may know, the foundation is very interested in particularly supporting the education of scientists for public policy, for support of public policy. We do that because we think that's a good investment. Some of us do that because we have found ourselves as a technical expert at times when we certainly were aware that high school physics was not exactly the best background to take on that role, and that we ought to look to our educational institutions to provide us with people who are both technically able and interested and aware of public policy and the way those decisions are made. So I think it's an obligation on the part of the educational communities around the world. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much.